Good morning, everybody. How are you? I hope you're well. Thank you for coming. After my snafu last week in forgetting to include the Lord's Prayer as a part of the sermon, even though it was clearly printed in the bulletin for me to read, I need to start this morning's worship service with an announcement. Do not forget that today is Benevolence Sunday. How's that, Megan? Is that doing better? Good. Today at the end of the service, as you leave, folks will be at the back doors with baskets in hand, ready to take a dollar or two or maybe more from you to help those within our community as they need. We're able to help folks keep the lights on, put food on the table, or maybe help with any other needs. Knowing my history of forgetting sometimes to mention that at the end of the service, I thought I'd start with it at the beginning, and maybe we'll make an Oreo with it, and I'll bring it up again at the end of the service too. How about that? I am so grateful you're here. What a great day we've been given. What a beautiful day that we've been given. After the rain and the clouds and the yuck and the muck of yesterday, we come out today and we see beautiful blue skies and feel the cool breeze upon our cheeks and reminding us what a beautiful world this can be. Then when we come to church today, we see each other in the halls, we sit around Sunday school tables and we listen and we learn and we enjoy each other's company. We come to a moment like this where we open our hearts and our minds and we sing and we listen. And today we get a chance to hear from some of the smallest voices within our church. Or maybe how about this? Some of the youngest voices in our church. But they have a beautiful message to sing to us today, to share in worship, in leadership themselves. And after the service today, we're going to go as a family downstairs to the fellowship hall to enjoy fun, food, and each other's company. What a beautiful day we have been given. I am grateful you are here, grateful on this Ascension Sunday, when we remember how Christ came to be a part of our lives, and when he went home, he asked us to continue the work, to continue his mission and his message. Today is a statement of our declaration of not only hearing that message, but accepting it. Our willingness to do our best to walk in his steps. To make that possible, we need not only him in our lives, but we need folks like you beside us through each and every step. I'm grateful you're here now for worship together. So will you do me a favor? Open your hearts, open your minds, make yourselves ready for worship. We'll start together by looking at this greeting we have here. Children of God, welcome. Welcome to this place of love and grace. Welcome to this place of hope and perseverance. God invites all of us to be a part of the beloved community. We are welcome just as we are. We are loved just as we are. In gratitude for all of this, let us worship God.
Thank you. Loving God, we are grateful for your presence in this place and grateful for the opportunity to offer our voices, our minds, our hearts, our entire being in praise to you. May we be changed for the experience. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, guys. How are you today? Are you excited? What are you excited about? The end of school. Yes. Yes. You're not. Oh. You love school that much. Wow, Callie. Well, guess what? I'm a teacher, and I don't want more homework, and I don't want more school. Well, it's the last week of school, and I know we're excited. I'm going to be a reading teacher at the same school. But anyway, we're all doing something after this school year, rising up. Well, today, Thomas already mentioned that it's Ascension Sunday. And being the teacher I am, I looked up the definition. Would you like to hear it? Okay. Ascension is the act of rising to an important position or higher level. Well, that's exactly what you're doing. First of all, you're important. And you're rising to a newer level. Well, do you remember Easter Sunday a few weeks ago? Well, the 40th day after that day is Ascension Sunday. And this is when Christ ascended to heaven. He came, before he ascended though, he told his disciples, you have got to continue the work I started. I'm going up to live with my Father, and you are going to be here to tell about Jesus and do good things for others and be nice. And so if Jesus is rising to a new height, isn't he? To a new place, just like you're rising to another grade. So it's similar to that, isn't it? Now, again, you're rising to a new grade, but you're not going the very next day, right? We're going to have summer, we're going to have Bible school, vacations, let's see, camps, Dogwood. You may go swimming. You might be going to the aquarium camp or the zoo camp. Oh, and JJ's birthday. So we got to do all that before we actually rise up to go into the next grade. But just don't forget what Jesus told his disciples, because we're his disciples too, aren't we? He wants us to be good as we're going into a new phase, a new place. Be nice to those around you. Be the best person you can be this summer when you go to all these camps and Bible school and Dogwood and wherever you're going. And then when you get to your next grade or your next school or your next job, don't forget to treat others just like Jesus would want you to treat them. So good luck as you rise up. I'll rise up with you on Wednesday and then some on Friday, I think, right? Yeah. All right, let's say a prayer together. Dear God, I thank you for every one of these children here. They're so special to the life of First Baptist Church, and I know First Baptist is important to them. And I just pray for them. I pray for the teachers. I pray for the cafeteria workers, the custodians. I pray for the principals, the assistant principals. I pray for teachers, students, everybody, as we all get ready to end this year and rise to the next year. Thank you for loving us, and may we always do what you would want us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Good job. Thank you.
Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. For the Lord, the Most High, is awesome, a great king over all the earth. He subdued peoples under our feet. He and nations under our and a nation he subdued people under us and nations under our feet. He chose our heritage for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loves. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a psalm. God is King over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the peoples gather as the people of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in the prayer of assurance. Ever-living God, your Son, Jesus Christ, once dwelt on earth, confined by time and space. In these days, give us faith to discern Christ's presence among us in every time and place.
May we be inspired by his life and guided by his light. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Riches I heed not, nor vain empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart, High King of heaven, my treasure thou art. Those are big words. Those words speak of a commitment, a dedication, and a place in your heart where Christ resides above all other things. Those are large and big, important words. Words that also echo what we hear here in 1 Peter. On Wednesday nights, throughout this past year, we've been studying the books. We've been doing a survey course of the New Testament, looking at the books themselves, the history, the context, the setting, the author, the intent. We recently looked at 1 Peter and looked at the setting and the background and the strife and the struggle that was going on. And words like this that we just sang would have rang so very true to them. Words of commitment and dedication that ask something of us. These words that we hear today from Peter are not just words, ancient stories, or recounting a time that was. Instead, they echo and ask for us to try to make that same heart our very own. So now hear these words. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in so far as you are sharing Christ's suffering, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when His glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that He may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on Him, because He cares for you. Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour, and resist him. Steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To Him be the power forever and ever. Amen. The Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It was Palm Sunday, 2017, when the bombs detonated. Pastor George was leading his congregation in worship there in Egypt when the blast ripped through the building where worshipers were gathered to remember Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. His was one of two churches that day that were targeted by those who believed that Christianity was a social blight that needed to be removed. Despite the loss of lives that took place that day, Pastor George entered back into that sanctuary. He preached the sermon he intended to preach that day, and in doing so, he gave thanks for the lives of those who had been so abruptly taken, offered prayers for those who had attacked them, and then bravely offered words of forgiveness for their hate. Billy lived in Sudan, where Christianity was almost non-existent. He grew up in a religious household, but his loved ones looked upon Christianity with much skepticism. They were heartbroken when he announced that he wanted to become a believer and a follower of Christ. They vowed to love him, but said, "We will never speak of this again." Some years later, Billy discovered another one that was like him that wanted to have a relationship with Jesus. And so they had formed an underground church. They had been able to find 15 others who were willing to meet with them. And it was then that their underground church was discovered. First, a young man named Libin was killed as he made his way to worship. Sometime later, it was a doctor who met the same fate, then a teacher, then a young couple, then a young man. It was all because he exited a bus in the city center on his way to worship. All because they were willing and wanting to attend this church. Billy has been able to survive and continues to plant churches despite the fears. And Kim grew up in a relatively wealthy family in North Korea. Their family had a treasured possession, a Christian Chinese Bible. They knew that their family would suffer greatly for even owning such an item because they were taught by the state that there were no gods. So Kim's mother had translated the book by hand at night in the quiet of their apartment. They would tell each other Bible stories, but they would only do so under the cover of a blanket so it would help muffle the words so that no one outside their apartment could hear the supposed heresy taking place within it. Each morning, Kim's father hugged her tight as he left for work, and he told her to go and have a good day and be brave. He had told her that loving Jesus was worth the risk of what might happen one day if he was ever discovered. And one day he was. He gave her a hug that morning and did not come home that afternoon. Kim never knew what happened to him, but she also says that she rests assured knowing that he is with the God who made him. Kim and her family were able to flee North Korea, and she speaks out today against the abuses of her home country. These are three modern stories of Christian persecution. And let us be aware that that wording, Christian persecution, is all too often abused in our times. Because there might be situations and there might be moments, there might be ordeals when we as Christians are not able or permitted to say, do, or act as maybe we or others wish they could. But they are far cries from true persecution of the faith. The text I read to you today from 1 Peter addresses a horrific time in the life of the early church. Because as that Christian message was starting to spread out through the Roman world, it was met with skepticism and it was met with derision. And those who chose to go another way, other than the Roman way, were then seen within society as being lost or ignorant or less than. And that kind of thinking then would make them easy targets for exploitation and scapegoating when necessary. And it was deemed necessary by some in 64 AD, just 30 years after the crucifixion of Christ, Rome burned. It was a horrific fire that consumed that ancient city. It started at the shops that were near the Chariot Stadium and quickly spread to the neighborhoods across that large city. For 6 days, the city burned. When it was finally put out, 2/3 of where Rome had been inhabited were now gone. Seeking someone to blame for the events and the loss, Emperor Nero targeted the Christian community. Believers were beaten, they were whipped, they were forced to fight in the arena. Some were even made to wear animal skins so they could be hunted by animals or hunters. So when Peter talks in his opening line today about the fiery ordeal that was taking place around them, he was hearkening back to the horrific events of Rome. He wanted to make a connection between the pain felt in the capital to the suffering being felt by believers across the known world. Being a follower of Jesus requires a cost, a suffering. It requires something from us. And today, as we gather and we celebrate and we remember Ascension Sunday, we remember that it's the day and the moment that Christ arose, not from the grave, but he arose from our midst. It was the moment that we were left. We were tasked with the continuance of his work. And let us be honest with each other, that work that he left us, it is hard. Turning the cheeks, that is hard. Loving our neighbors, that's hard. Sitting and eating with those who were unlike us, it is hard. Sharing in conversation instead of shouting at those who ridicule us is hard. Loving, truly loving the other that we see in our eye, we know them to be different and to be wrong in our sight, but to love them, to truly love them as Christ would, is hard. Being like Christ is hard. And to be like him, it will take something from us. To follow the charge left for us will tax us beyond what some of us might believe is possible. I found this quote this week, and I thought it just summed it up beautifully. Jesus has many who love his kingdom in heaven, but few who bear his cross. He has many who desire comfort, but few who desire suffering. He finds many to share his feast, but few his fasting. And all desire to rejoice with him, but few are willing to suffer for his sake. Many follow Jesus to break the bread, but few want to drink the cup of passion. Many admire the miracles, but just a few follow him to the humiliation of the cross. Many love Jesus as long as no hardship touches them. What we don't have, and what we recognize on Ascension Sunday, is that we no longer have Christ beside us, as some once did. Instead, what we have is Christ living inside of us. And because of that, that connection and that commitment, he's asking something from us. And he's asking us to help bear the cross. That means we're to work. Work tirelessly. We are to work to make our reality look more like the kingdom on earth that Jesus wanted to establish. Now, Pastor George and Billy and Kim were asked to give more for their faith than I think any of us have been or probably will be. But no doubt, something is being asked of us. Something more than maybe you are giving now. And there is a promise ahead for us. There is a glory that we just cannot yet fully fathom. But before it comes, before the riches that are set aside for us are ours, there is work to be done. Kingdom work. Christ-like work. Right here, right now. And He's asked you, every one of you, to help. And He believes that you can do it because He is inside of you. Will you join me? God, you ask a lot, but I bet it pales in comparison of all that we ask of you. We come to you with our laundry list, our hopes, our desires, our wants, our needs, and we fill your ears with our words. And yet sometimes we forget to stop talking so we can hear. We can hear what it is you are trying to say to us. To continue, to love, to share grace, to be a non-anxious presence. And when you look, and when we look at our world and we look at what you're asking us to do, it feels so overwhelming. We're not quite sure where to start, so we end up just pausing, freezing in the moment, unsure of how to act. And yet you've equipped us to go forward, to make the world a better place, starting with us. God, help us to see our own importance in your eyes. Help us believe in ourselves the way that you believe in us. Help our eyes and our hearts envision a world the way that you see it. And may we have the courage flow through us to take those first steps to make that reality a possibility. And with all we do, may it be filled with your grace. Along the way, may our words be one of encouragement and inclusion. And may we continue to be models, not only of your message, but your Son. For we say this in His most holy name. Amen. Riches I heed not, nor vain empty praise. Thou my inheritance, now and always. Thou and thine only, first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art. We know that He truly is the treasure of our lives. But for us to enjoy, for us to be able to realize the true gift that we have, it'll take more from us than maybe we are giving. As we stand and we sing about this love that is being given to us, a love that has no bounds, let us think about our love, our reciprocal acts of graciousness and gratitude, and let's think about how maybe we can stretch our bounds to show Him just how truly treasured He is. Will you stand and sing with us?
Thank you.
as we offer our prayers for those within our community and those within the circles of our lives, I encourage you to remember these folks: Max Bonner, Ralph Graham, Faith Watkins Houston, who grew up here at First Baptist, and Richard Sullivan's sister, Mary Schmid. I'm sure there are others that you're aware of, and I encourage you to take a moment and bring those to mind and to heart, and invite you now to join me in prayer. Jesus Christ, mediator and sibling, we thank you for becoming human and for experiencing the joys and sorrows of life, which assures us that you are able to sympathize, and rejoice with us. We praise you for the many joys of life, for the beauty of creation, for your work in this world, for the support and joy that we find here in community, and for the gift of life, both now and forever. As our mediator, you stand before God, petitioning him on our behalf, so we boldly bring before you our prayers. Prayers for creation and its care, for this community of faith and those we name with particular needs, for our city, for our nation, for our world. Prayers for vision and passion as we strive to be your body, offering love, acceptance, and relevance in these crucial days and beyond. We offer our gratitude to you, O Christ, and we pray this in your name. Amen.
Through our offering, may those who are weary be energized. May those who feel forgotten find community. May those who are lost be led home. May those who live in need experience abundance. Pray with me, please. Dear Heavenly God, from whom all blessings flow, thank you for these offerings. We bring them to you and ask that you show us how to use them. We ask your help in assisting the weary, the forgotten, the lost, those who live in need, all of our neighbors. Show us how best to serve these and others, and we will give you all the glory. Amen.
Folks, just a few announcements before we go today. You might have heard me mention earlier, don't forget today is Benevolent Sunday. We'd love to see you at the back doors with baskets as you go. Today, 2:30 in the chapel, is the School of Fine Arts recital that's going on today. They will be awarding the Maxine Polston Piano Award, which gives a full scholarship for the next year for that student. It's a big deal. It's a wonderful way to remember Maxine. And if you have an opportunity to be with us today at 2:30, we'd love to see you there for that one. Youth information went out via email reminding youth tonight, 4:30, Puerto Rico mission trip prep with Jeff, normal spot, normal time. Parents, 6:30 tonight, information on the trip, and that meeting is going to be in the chapel. Look forward to having you there. And I got a text just a couple minutes ago letting me know that the chicken and mac and cheese have arrived. The baked beans are downstairs. You all have brought lots of salads, wonderful desserts. Some of the banana pudding has already made its way to my office. So we're in great shape with that. If you did not bring something with you, do not let that stop you from coming and joining us downstairs for the fellowship. There is plenty of food to be had and even more fellowship that will nurture your soul just like the food's going to enrich your belly. We hopefully to see you downstairs for that. When you're done here, go on downstairs. There are tables galore. Go ahead and have a seat at the table. Start talking. I'll be down in just a minute. I'll give us a blessing and then we'll give you some instructions on how to get the food and we'll get underway with that. And there is a treat for you when you get down there on the table. There are cards for you to take that Francis Morandi was kind enough to make for us that tell you how to access the members only section on the website. It will give you the password. It'll walk you through how to get to there because what you'll want to see on there is the directory. We're going to be able to put fun and exciting things like financial documents on there, right? Committee meeting notes and those kinds of things. You'll want to make sure you have access to it. That card, when you go join us for lunch downstairs, we'll be glad to take that with you and share that. But before we go, will you guys love and greet and hug those around you? And then I'll call us back for a benediction in a moment. All right, friends. All right, everybody. Save it for the tables. Look at you. Good to see you guys. So, folks, when we go and we talk a little bit about the fact that something's needed, something's required, something's asked of us, We will be faced and given opportunities to be Christ-like this week. Whether that means holding our tongue, whether that means giving some grace, whether that means just sitting and listening, whether that means holding a hand, or whether it means just trying to find a new and different way to be like Him. Being like Christ is not easy. And yet He asked us to go. And He knew that it would be hard, and He knew that it wouldn't be too easy for us, and that it would take something from us. So He gave us a piece of Himself to live inside of each and every one of us. And that's not only what He's asking us to use as our inspiration for making this world a better place, it's what He's asking us to share with them to change it. Inside of you is all you need to help make this world a better place. And it starts with what you have. It starts with Him. So go this week and find a new and different way to listen to Him. Find a new and different way to be like Him. And then find a way to share Him. And then you will see, bit by bit, this looking more and more like the kingdom He always wanted it to be. In His name, amen.